Live from the Civic Media World Headquarters in Madison, Wisconsin, it's the Todd Allbar Show. And now, pursuing truth wherever it may lead, here's your host, Todd Allbar.
Across Wisconsin on the Civic Media Radio Network and streaming worldwide on the Civic Media app. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Todd Allbar, along with Mr. Aaron Zomers, our producer and engineer, doing an outstanding job on the board. It is Friday, TGIF. Thank goodness it's Friday, November 17th, 2023. 6 minutes past, Six minutes now past the hour of 12 noon is what he's trying to say. Mr. Zomers, we have reached the end of the week. I, for one, am happy to have it be here.
Yeah, I can't disagree.
It's another beautiful day here in the capital city, high atop State Street at the world headquarters of Civic Media, a block off the Capitol Square. Cooler, a little cool, about, they say about 20 degrees cooler today than it was yesterday. But anyway, we'll take what we can get because next week it's going to get really chilly, they say.
So I've heard.
yes. So anyway, hopefully you're going to have a great weekend plans. I want to start out the show today because we don't have any, you know, automatic numbers on how the show did or how it did ratings-wise overnight. We don't have that. But what we do have is Mom. And every once in a while, you understand, you get a text or a phone call from Mom saying, well, you know, that was a really good show. I enjoyed it.
Or why would you say that on the radio?
Yes. The results are in from yesterday. And I got a text and then a call from Mom last night about yesterday's show. And thank goodness, you know, the audience yesterday, I mean, it just, you know, we have a brand new audience today. So, but anyway, Mom called and was not her best work. To put it kindly, is Mom was just a little concerned, thought I was a little hyped up. So the best she said, well, thank goodness you had that guy on in the last half hour. That really saved it. And she's not wrong. Matt Solomon did a great job yesterday. So that was the best part of the show, probably.
Yes, I would agree with that. But yeah. I don't think the show was bad. I just think it was goofy. And, well, and the first half of the second hour was very goofy.
And that was exactly her point. She was worried if I was okay.
Are you?
I will tell you, I'm medicated today, so I'm doing absolutely great.
All right.
So anyway, I'm happy to be here. So we were, and the beauty about having a daily show is you get to start over and just bada bing, bada boom, you're off to the races the next day. So I think we have a great show on tap today.
Also, we have a listener in WGBW texting in, disagrees with your mom. I thought really? Yesterday was awesome. What?
Really? Okay. Well, that's, see, not everybody. Mom's barometer is slightly different. She takes it very personally because she kind of knows me and she can tell by how much caterwauling I'm doing, how much laughing, what my mood is probably.
Right, right.
But, well, I appreciate the listener up at WGBW up in Green Bay. I mean, yeah, it was a fun show. We have another great show for you today. It is opening weekend of gun deer season, which is a big deal for a lot of people across the state of Wisconsin. So going to be spending a little bit of time talking about that. Also, a great editorial in yesterday's Cap Times here in Madison talking about the chairman of the Joint Finance Committee, Howard Marklein, who represents Southwest Wisconsin, back where I am from. And as a matter of fact, I was quoted in the piece. But that's not why I'm going to talk about it today. I'm going to be asking you, do you feel that your legislator, either state representative or state senator, do you think that your legislator is doing enough for you? So we'll talk about that a little bit. And but where I want to start today is for those watching on the stream, either on Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, or whatever, I once again have my Wisconsin basketball sweatshirt on as the Wisconsin Badger basketball team is going to try to get back on track tonight. They are at home in the Kohl Center taking on the ever-popular Robert Morris University. I say that tongue-in-cheek.
Who?
Yes. Robert Morris University, not a powerhouse. The Badgers got blown away out in Providence, out in Rhode Island, earlier this week. Was not their best work. So, and of course, I was at the game last Friday here in Madison at the Kohl Center, where they took on a really tough top 10 team in Tennessee and kept it close until the end and could have won that game, quite frankly. Played really, really well. And then went to Providence. But I've only kind of driven through a little part of Rhode Island. Seems like a beautiful place. And no offense to Providence, but boy, that's a long trip, you know, to go all the way out there and try to get ginned up. And anyway, so I'm gonna say this loss at Providence was a one-off. I'm still excited about the Badger men's basketball team this year. And my friend Jeff had an extra ticket, once again asked me to go along. So we're going to meet up after work here and make our way to the Kohl Center. Tip-off time tonight at 6 p.m. And you can hear the game right here on the Civic Media Radio Network. If you live in the municipalities or thereabouts of Wisconsin Rapids, you can listen to it over the air on WFHR of Wisconsin Rapids. Also listen in the Richland Center area in southwest Wisconsin on WRCE, and also up in Amory, WLAK, our affiliate or our station up there. If you don't live in either Wisconsin Rapids, Richland Center, or Amory, have no fear, because you can still listen. Because of Badger Sports, we are allowed to stream that on the Civic Media app. So you can stream it for free. Won't cost you a dime if you don't have it. Simply download it on your Apple or Android device and then scroll down to one of those stations. I always go to my hometown station, WRCE News from the Center in Richland Center, Wisconsin. Just click on that. You can hear the call tonight with Matt LePay and Brian Butch on the Badger Radio Networks. Again, tip-off time at 6 p.m. tonight for Wisconsin Badger basketball as they take on Robert Morris University. Hopefully they get back on track.
I hope so, because Robert Morris, I don't know.
Or Robert whoever, Morris.
No, I know. Just whoever that is, if we don't beat them, right, who are we?
Don't worry. It's going to be great.
Where is Robert Morris University? Do you have any idea?
No, that's a great trivia question. I'm going to, let me guess. Robert Morris University, I'm going to say it's a Southern school. It's probably like, Robert Morris is probably like South Carolina.
It is Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania.
Of course it is. Pittsburgh, really? Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania is where Robert Morris is. All right. I knew a guy once by the name of Chad Morris, but never knew Robert Morris. So anyway, and then tomorrow, also on the big sport, thanks to our executive producer, Luke Mathers, for giving us this great list of what's going on. Also tonight, if you're not a University of Wisconsin men's basketball fan, perhaps you're a Bucks fan. And now wait a minute here. We're going to have to get some clarification. Get some clarification, you understand? Over the break here, because I'm and this would be a great. I should have attended dress rehearsal earlier this morning, and I didn't. Because also it says Friday, November 17th, the Milwaukee Bucks at the Charlotte Hornets. Tip off time is 6 p.m. Also on WRCE. Now I'm no super great engineer, but I do know you can't have two things on at the same time.
Yeah,
I would think if I know my WRCEs. I would think probably the Badger men's basketball game will be on RCE.
Well, I can tell you that will at least be what's on the app, because we cannot play the Bucks on the app.
Very good point. Yeah, so the Bucks were not on the app. So we'll get some clarification which stations the Bucks are playing on versus the Badgers, let you know a little bit later. I do know that tomorrow on Saturday, November 18th for college football, the Nebraska Cornhuskers come to town. And they're going to be here in Madison, and it's a big primetime game on NBC. Big primetime game. Wisconsin taking on the Cornhuskers, and you can listen to that on those same stations, WRCE Richland Center, also WRJN in Racine, Kenosha, WFHR up in Wisconsin Rapids, and WLAK in Amory, Wisconsin. Tip-off for that one tomorrow night for Badger football, 6:30. Now, look. The Badgers football team needs one more game to get bowl eligible. And so it's either got to be tomorrow night against the Cornhuskers or next week against the Flexters, better known as the Gophers, the Minnesota Golden Gophers, the PJ Flexters. I'm worried about that game, quite frankly, because PJ Fleck, as annoying as the dude is, he knows how to get his team up and excited. The guy is just, he is just a bundle of prescription drugs and energy. I'm not sure about that. But the guy, he has a lot of energy. and he knows, and they he knows how to get his team riled up for the competition of the axe.
And right now, if there's one thing the Badgers football team is missing, it is energy.
Exactly. And so I'm worried about that game up there at Minnesota coming up next week. But let's take one step at a time. Let's stay positive and hope the Wisconsin Badgers can get back on track with Nebraska tomorrow night at Camp Randall. And again, the kickoff time, 6:30. You can hear the game right here on the Civic Media Radio Network on any of our stations, including WRCE in Richland Center, WRJN Racine Kenosha, WFHR in Wisconsin Rapids, WLAK in Amory. Or again, you can click on the Civic Media app tomorrow night and listen to it there. And NBC, I mean, boy, two Big Ten West teams that are not doing real great, and that's their primetime lineup.
So, well, I mean, could be worse.
It could be worse.
Could be watching it on Peacock.
I want to see you, Peacock. You, Peacock.
You know what? It is on Peacock, too. It's It's on, but you can also get it over the air for free on NBC.
I feel like that is the better option.
Yes. Or if you have the Peacock, you can do it there as well. Also, over the weekend, on Saturday, the Bucks playing at 6 p.m. So, again, on select stations, you could get the Bucks game. And then on Sunday, November 19th, you have the Packers at home against the Los Angeles Chargers. And you can listen to that starting at 12 noon kickoff on WRCO FM 100.9 Richland Center, WRJN in Racine Kenosha, and WCQM up in Park Falls. Up in beautiful Park. Pardon me, Park Falls up in northern Wisconsin. So that's your big, lots of sports going on. That's what's going on, and hopefully maybe you're going to be out on the deer stand, right? And so that's the question I want to start off with. Wisconsin deer hunting is a family tradition for a lot of families. I think it's great. I think that the herd needs to be culled, so to speak. I myself started deer hunting years ago and then quit several years ago after the big CWD controversy. And anyway, so I'm not going to be out in the woods, but for those of you who are, perhaps you're driving to your spot right now, maybe you're listening to us, give us a deer story. Give us one of your favorite memories of going deer hunting, whether you're a hunter now or whether you used to be. Give us a call and give us one of your favorite deer hunting stories. 844-967-2789. 844-967-2789. Or text us on the Civic Media app. What is your favorite deer hunting story? As we enter the opening weekend of gun deer season, stay with us. This is the Todd Allball Show, and this is the Civic Media Radio Network. Truth, wherever it may lead, and having fun doing it. Welcome back to the Todd Allball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. Glad to have you along with us on this Friday, November 17th, 2023, 20 now past the hour of 12 noon. Perhaps you're taking a walk on a beautiful sunny day, at least here in Madison. Cooler here today, but still sunny, beautiful autumn fall day. Wanted to take a minute to just talk about Wisconsin deer hunting, which I understand not everybody is into, not everybody's a fan of. But I think for a lot of Wisconsinites, it is a family tradition. It's a friend tradition. A lot of people, a lot of communities will, you know, restaurants, bars, what have you, make a lot of money this weekend with the opening of Gun Deer Weekend. What are your favorite memories, favorite story of going deer hunting with family or friends over the years? Give us a call. 844-967-2789, 844-967-2789, or text us on the Civic Media app. I started hunting, I can't remember, I guess, well, I was out in the woods with my granddad and my dad and uncles and whatnot, probably around, I don't know, 9, 10, 11, somewhere in there, just helping, you know, do drives and whatnot, things like that. You kind of drive through the woods, you kind of walk alongside your dad or your uncle or what have you, and help do a deer drive. And then went through hunter safety at around 11, 12. And my first gun that I went deer hunting with was a gift from my granddad, and it was a Remington 3030. great little pump action rifle there, and went out. It's a light gun, you know, to go through the brush or whatnot. Great gun to hunt with. And so I had a 30-30 out there and used that for several years. And then eventually inherited and got one of my granddad's 30-06s, which is another great with a scope, a nice scope and everything. So, but I think for me, it wasn't so much whether I harvested a deer as it was just being out in the woods with family and friends. A lot of time, especially on Saturday afternoon, if you'd already got at least one deer, you did, you know, we did a little truck hunting, which, you know, you drive the truck or the vehicle to the back of the farm, back by the woods, and you sit in the truck. You know, you're going to be outside the truck, you know, and but you'd be sitting in the truck listening to Matt LaPay call the Badger game and you know, having some hot chocolate and some cookies and a bologna. Probably, you know, the best thing about it is you'd have a venison bologna sandwich, or you're eating venison while you're sitting there waiting for deer to come through. And so you did that, and then maybe on Sunday, you know, you sat and you listened to, you know, at the time, Jim Irwin and Max McGee called the Packer game. But it was time just to hang out with family, to catch up, listen or watch a little football, do some gun deer hunting, have a bowl of chili, come in for lunch at lunchtime, have a bowl of chili, and then get back out there. And you try to at least get one deer that opening weekend. So you think, well, at least we got something in the freezer.
Right.
You, Mr. Somers? I know you've done some deer hunting in your time.
Yeah, it's definitely been a thing I do with my family. There are two main places we go hunting. My dad has access to some land about half an hour north of Manitowoc, and mm-hmm. we go there. But there's also a cabin that my grandpa has up north. And both are really good places for deer hunting. It's just more of a trip to the cabin, like a 3.5 hour drive or whatever. So that's more like the classic deer camp thing where everybody stays there for like a week or whatever. And we didn't really do any truck hunting as for me, but the similar thing, something that sounds very similar to that, is if we had a deer or two, then we'd listen to the game or whatever on the radio in the garage up north while we're all cleaning the deer together, which for those of you who haven't hunted, that might sound gross. Cleaning as in like
butchering
it.
All right. I mean, you've harvested the deer, and it takes somebody who really knows what they're doing. Now, my granddad, he knew how to do that. So there were usually we would take our deer to the locker plant to get processed because we just weren't that good at making our own bologna or whatever. If you just want to like cut them up into steaks or whatever, but I mean, you know, we always took it to the local locker plant, in particular the Richland Locker and Richland Center, who does a great job, by the way. Cannot do better, I don't think, than those guys right there.
We would still bring it in, but we'd cut all the meat off the bone and stuff ourselves because then you don't have to pay for someone else to do that.
Right.
And it's not really that difficult. It's also not gross. Like if you've ever cooked raw meat, it's just like that, except you're cutting it off the bone.
The statute of limitations has long since expired. So I'll tell one of the stories. There may or may not. I cannot confirm or deny. But there may or may not have been a time or two when I was young and there was a larger hunting party. And at that time, there was all these rules about you could only, you know, there was, they called it a party tag, where only one person in your party could harvest a doe, a female deer.
Right.
Everybody else had to get a buck. And so, and you know, you didn't have cell phones in those times. You might have had a bad walkie-talkie. But if you were hunting with, you know, 10, 12 people and you were spread over, you know, 100 acres, you didn't always communicate. So there may or may not have been a time when someone harvested an extra, or as we say back in Richland Center, an extra. You might have had an extra once you got all back to, you're like, holy crap, you know what I'm going to do? So you may have had to quickly clean and process that deer and put it in the freezer. It may have happened a time or two over the course, you know, of our deer hunting time.
Now with cell phones, it's a lot easier for that to not happen.
Yes.
And to not be a violator.
I can't confirm or deny. I'm just saying these things on occasion happen. Bad communication back in the, you know, late 70s, early 80s, as it were.
Well, even pretty recently, I remember hunting with walkie-talkies before we all had cell phones.
Mm.
They were probably a lot better.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And that's not to say I condone any of that. And certainly, you know, that's, you didn't get into poaching and all that kind of terrible stuff. I mean, that's terrible. But, you know, I think if you hunt long enough, you get into one of those situations, apparently, you know, especially if you hunt with a large group of people and under those rules at the time where it was just all this party tag stuff. And then it got to be one of the reasons I got out of deer hunting was because when CWD, chronic wasting disorder, broke out, and that, you know, that kind of makes you think a little bit because, you know, I got my own problems with my brain. I don't need mad cow disease. But then I'll never forget this. One of the last years that my dad and my sister and I hunted, I was one of those that I'd get the rule book like the week before I got my license and I'd actually read it. I'd actually go through and make sure I knew what the rules were, what changes had happened. And one of the last years I hunted, they had earn a buck. And so you had to, you know, hunt, you had to, some units, every state, you know, the state is broken up into units. Sometimes they roughly align with county lines. Sometimes they don't. And so in your unit, you had to, you could only, you know, earn a buck. You had to get a doe first, antlerless deer first. And so we got to noon and honest to goodness, the way it was written, I didn't know for sure. And so we went into town to a DNR station and I asked the dude, he had the map. I said, that's our farm. Can I just shoot anything or do I have to earn a buck? And he goes, well, I think you can shoot anything. Well, let me check with my associate here. Another DNR guy comes over and he goes, oh no, you got to earn a buck. Like literally they couldn't tell me. And I'm like, the rules have just gotten, it's kind of like the reason that fishing got ruined for me. All the different, you know, rules. You have to bring a slide ruler and everything else to go fishing.
All you need is if you have a boat, just have a sticker on your boat. That's a measuring tape.
That's true. I'm a simple man, Mr. Zommers. I just, you know, I want to just be outside and I can do that. Anyway, if you're going gun deer hunting, good luck, be safe, and hunt wisely. Have a good hunt all across the state of Wisconsin. We'll come back and talk about your legislators across Wisconsin after this on the Todd Allball Show and Civic Media. Wherever it may lead, and having fun doing it. Welcome back to the Todd Allball Show on the 7th, on the Civic Media Radio Network. I was looking at 17th of November. Got things confused. It is Friday, November 17th, 2023. Mr. Aaron Zommers on the board. Glad to have you along with us. Want to turn to this article in the Capital Times from yesterday. Great editorial by the editorial staff there, entitled, Marklein has done nothing for universities and communities he represents. Talking about Howard Marklein from Southwest Wisconsin represents just south of Wisconsin Rapids near Nisita area, kind of Nisita down to Mauston and all of Juneau County, and then down through near the Dells and Sauk County, over all of Richland County, then south of the Wisconsin River, Iowa County, including Dodgeville, kind of close to where House of the Rock is, over to Grant County, which goes all the way to the Mississippi River, University of Wisconsin, Platteville area, down to the line of the state line of Illinois, over to Lafayette County, including Darlington, and then over into Greene County and the beautiful city of Monroe. So it's geographically, it's a huge area to cover in Southwest Wisconsin. And in fairness, it was the area that my former boss, Dale Schultz, represented before he retired and left the legislature, and Howard Marklein succeeded him. And you've heard me talk on this program before, my frustration with Senator Howard Marklein and Tony Kurtz and others who, for whatever reason, have decided to really not represent the area. So my question to you, and I truly am interested in this, it's not obviously not a scientific poll, but just out of listeners and what you feel. Do you feel that your state legislator, be it your state representative or your state senator, do you feel that they are representing you and your best interests in the state legislature? 844-967-2789, 844-967-2789. You can also text us on the Civic Media app. Download it on your Apple or Android device. There's a button there to text in or call in as well. Do you feel, and again, I don't have all the legislators for all of our different cities that we cover in my head, but no, Civic Media now has a very broad swath all across the state of Wisconsin. We cover, you know, central southwest Wisconsin, Richland Center area. It kind of goes out from there. La Crosse, also Eau Claire, Chippewa Falls, Amory area up to, you know, Hudson, Park Falls, Wisconsin Rapids, Wausau, Green Bay, Oshkosh, the Fox Valley, WAUK, into Milwaukee, Waukesha, WRJN, Racine, Kenosha. It's a large part of the state that Civic Media is over. So whether your legislator is Republican, Democratic, do you feel that your legislator is doing enough to represent you? Article in the Capital Times starts out this editorial. Howard Marklein is one of the most powerful members of the state legislature, an ambitious political careerist who was first elected to the state assembly in 2010 and has served in the state Senate since 2014. Marklein was president pro tem of the Senate from 17 through 2021 and currently serves as the Senate co-chair of the legislature's powerful Joint Finance Committee. In his finance committee position, he literally forges the state budget. As such, he is better positioned than just about anyone else in the Capitol to make sure the resources are directed to valuable and necessary projects, like keeping our state's universities open and strong. Yet when it comes to supporting universities in his 17th Senate district, which includes all of southwestern Wisconsin's Grant, Lafayette, Juneau, and Richland counties, much of Sauk, western Iowa, parts of Greene County, and stretches of eastern Vernon County, Marklein keeps coming up short. So says the Capital Times. Earlier this year, as we have reported on this show, the former University of Wisconsin Richland campus and Richland Center ended its last semester. After more than 55 years as part of the UW system, providing Wisconsin students as well as many international scholars with the courses they needed to begin work on more than 200 majors. The Richland campus stopped providing in-person classes. UW Richland, which was known in its last year as UW-Platteville Richland, did not shut down because people in Richland Center, Richland County, or the rest of southwest Wisconsin wanted it to go. In fact, they desperately wanted to save the school. They rallied to prevent the closure of the campus and make sound arguments for how to renew and expand services. So why did it close? The UW Board of Regents pointed to declining enrollment, but the real issue was declining support from state government. Richland County officials argued that enrollment figures dropped because the school had been undermined by the cutting of dedicated recruiting staff, international education initiatives, and popular programs such as College for Kids. Could the state have provided more money for UW Richland? Of course. Wisconsin has a huge budget surplus, at the time over $7.1 billion, now down to around $4. So the money was available to save UW Richland and other threatened campuses in the state. If only there had been a veteran legislator who is in a position to advocate for campuses that were targeted for cuts and closures. Someone who served, for instance, as co-chair of the Joint Finance Committee. And if only that legislator were committed to doing the right thing by UW Richland, Richland Center, Richland County, and southwest Wisconsin. The Capital Times writes, if only Howard Marklein had put his constituents and their communities ahead of partisan loyalty to the Republican leadership in the legislature, who is currently at war with the UW system because Assembly Speaker Robin Voss doesn't like diversity, equity, and inclusion programs. But Marklein failed to come through for UW Richland. Indeed, former legislative aide, and they list me in this piece, and quoted me as saying that it was set up for failure. And of course it was. My question is, wherever you live in Wisconsin, has your legislator done enough to represent you? 844-967-2789, 844-967-2789. Let's go to the phone lines. Speaking of Richland County, one of the great municipalities, not too far from the home farm, Yuba, Wisconsin. Let's go to Lee in Yuba. Lee, thanks for listening and calling in. What say you?
Hey, Todd, I couldn't agree with you more. Your assessment of Marklein and Kurtz and Tranel and whoever the other one is.
Todd Novak from Dodgeville represents parts of Richland County as well.
Novak. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they've really done us a disservice. I'm a retired teacher, and you know what they're doing to education overall is just an atrocious move on their part. He wants people to be trained to work in factories instead of being able to think, and I think it's totally useless. They've had several listening meetings, and that's the problem. They get to listen and pretend they're writing stuff down and nod their heads, but they will not answer any questions or do anything. But they've really decimated, or they're in the process of decimating the system. Platteville, when we were attached to Platteville, which was a big mistake, stole the students that we had here that were foreign exchange students that brought in money. And I mean, we're doing well. COVID kind of came in and created a problem for everyone. Mm-hmm. But then they had no interest in education. I think they really, really messed things up, and they do not represent the best interests of our community. So I'll listen to your response, and I thank you so much for bringing this topic up, because I think it's who we are, Wisconsinites. We're forward, mm-hmm. and these people are going backwards. So thanks, Todd.
Hey, thank you, Lee. Really appreciate the call. Lee from Yuba out in southwest Wisconsin. Asking the question, do you feel that your legislator, no matter where you live in Wisconsin, no matter this program goes statewide across the state, do you feel that your legislator represents your interests? 844-967-2789, 844-967-2789, or you can text us on the app. I appreciate Lee's call from Yuba, and this is the one that I'm most keenly aware of, this set of legislators, just because A, I am from that area, B, and in complete full disclosure, I've set up this program before. One of my deep regrets in politics, not all, but there are some regrets, certainly. One of them is that I actually helped get Howard Marklein elected to the assembly in 2010. Went out and did doors for him on a couple, three different occasions. Attended his inauguration, and a lot of us thought this is going to be great. He seems like a decent guy. Boy, were we wrong. So, I have to take partial responsibility for this guy. And the sad thing is, he's very much like Howard Marklein is very much like Scott Walker. The way that they campaigned and the way that they governed are very different. Kind of a bamboozlement, if you will. And Lee's absolutely right. I went to some of these meetings in Richland County when they were discussing the closure of the campus. And I think what frustrates me and a lot of other people is that there was overwhelming support in the community for saving the campus. And people are not stupid out there, all right? They realize that there might have to be some give and take. Certainly in today's world, the mission of the facility might change. Things can't stay stagnant or the same. But again, I go back to, we had about a year ago, we had a former chancellor of the UW colleges on this program. And she said she had put together in 2018 a proposal to change the mission, but not to close any of the 13 two-year center campuses, Kathy Sandine. And when you went to Richland Center, I assume at Washington County, and I assume at Fond du Lac as well, these other campuses are closing, you didn't see a bunch of all Democrats in the audience. You didn't see a bunch of all Republicans. What you saw was a mix, and nobody there at these meetings that I heard tried to make this a partisan issue. And there were all these signs in Richland County that said Save Our Campus. And those signs that said Save Our Campus were in the yards of people who normally put up Biden signs and people who normally put up Trump signs. This is an issue that cut across party lines. People said, I don't care about partisanship. This campus is good for our community. And the fact is that Howard Marklein, in particular, and Tony Kurtz and others did not listen to their own constituents. And this is what I find the most disturbing, is that legislators have stopped listening to their constituents. 844-967-2789. 844-967-2789. Let's go to the phones. Karina in Milwaukee. Thanks for calling, Karina. Do you feel your legislator represents your interests?
Oh, I don't think so. And I'm here in this country as of 1995, and the difference, radical difference between is the healthcare and education, because I never could understand at first. I couldn't understand at first, and now I do, why such a great country would not invest in education and healthcare. And I understood at some point, especially where the Trump come up in the play, that it's easy to rule and fool sick and dumb people.
Yeah.
No. And that's what they're trying to do.
Yeah, it's
they don't want to provide health care. They don't want to provide education. So you don't have an intelligent conversation and just move people as a stuck.
Right. And I don't mean to put you on the spot, about 20 seconds left, but you're a state senator and state representative. Have you ever talked to them? Do you know who they are? You're ones that represent you?
Honestly, I don't.
Yeah. A lot of people don't.
I don't.
A lot of people don't. That's because they stay so isolated, right, and insulated. Karina, always great. Love your calls. Thank you so much. Appreciate it, Karina. If you're on the lines, do not hang up. We will take your call on the other side. More on if your legislator represents you. Don't go anywhere. This is the Todd Ball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. Wherever it may lead, and having fun doing it. Welcome back to the Todd Ball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. Now 10 before the hour of 1 o'clock on Friday, November 17th. Mr. Zommer's on the board. Glad to have you along with us. Glad for the phone calls and participation. You can text us on the Civic Media app or give us a call there as well. Talking about this opinion page, this opinion editorial in the Capital Times, calling out State Senator Howard Marklein, Republican of the Spring Green area in Southwest Wisconsin, who happens to be the co-chair of the very powerful Joint Finance Committee, the Budget Writing Committee. And it's known as the co-chair as one of the most powerful positions in the state legislature. Past co-chairs have wielded enormous power to either help their home district or do good things in Wisconsin. I mean, they're controlling the committee that controls the money, where our tax dollars go. And the Cap Times points out that in this case of the closure of the UW Richland campus, Howard Marklein had the power to step in and use his abilities, his position, to save that campus, and he chose not to. And so the question I have for you across the state of Wisconsin is, do you feel that your legislator is representing your interests? 844-967-2789, 844-967-2789, off the text line, WMDX here in Madison. Question, do you think the Republicans want these buildings free for private schools? A great question by the caller here in Madison. I don't know is the short answer. Certainly there is a movement, an attack on public education, both K-12 and post-secondary. But in this case, it appears that the state is going to, because the way these two-year centers are set up under the lease and contract, the buildings are maintained by the state, or by the buildings are maintained rather by the counties. And the state does all the programming. So the buildings are technically still, the land is still owned by the county. And so there's a lot of legal things they have to go through here. So the buildings are not going to go into private schools unless the county would somehow make some sort of an arrangement for that. And that's a long legal part of it. But great, great question. The short answer is I don't think so. Let's go to the phone lines, 844-967-2789, 844-967-2789. From Central Wisconsin, Dennis in Central Wisconsin. Thanks for calling. Go ahead.
Thanks for taking my questions. And to answer your question of whether they're responsible, legislators are responsible to the constituents, my answer is no.
And do you? And again, I don't mean to put you on the spot. You don't have to name them, but do you? Have you ever met? Do you know who your state senator and assembly person is or not?
Oh yeah, I'm Senator Cheston from over at Point. I've emailed or texted both my senator and my legislator assembly person in regards to being able to legalize medical marijuana or hemp in this. In this state, we're surrounded by states that have it, not only medical but also recreational, and we're just losing a source of revenue for the state that is slipping over the borders.
And did you get a response back of your email?
Well, yes. Testing sent me an email back and says he's responsible. He was going to start out. Legislative, what would you call it, proposal for medical marijuana. You know, so I waited and waited, and nothing. It either went in committee and got burnt out there by the Republicans, or it never materialized because the Democrats are trying to get it legalized right away.
Right.
And the people that are doing this don't know the first thing of whether it's good for you or bad for you.
Yeah.
And you ask the doctor, and they don't want to say nothing because they don't want to hang their legs up.
Dennis, I really appreciate the call. I got other people I got to get to. But Dennis, thank you so much. Call back again. We appreciate your listenership. Let's go quickly to Port Edwards. Beautiful Port Edwards. Rob in Port Edwards, you are on. Do you feel that your legislator represents your interests? Rob, go ahead.
Hello. Hi. I'm sorry. I believe I've got Teston and Scott Krug and the fantabulous Van Orden, meaning we're not very well represented. Mm-hmm. And looking at the actual issue of funding education, whether it's Richland Center or it's Madison or whichever, this is out of the Koch brothers' playbook. And they are very, very content, in fact, excited if there is a very dumb electorate. Mm-hmm. The less people know, the less educated they are, and you know this, right?
Mm-hmm.
If you swim in this pond, there's folks that are not dumb or stupid, but they're ill-informed or naive.
Yep.
And as long as those folks are being fed, you know, the lightest, bright, shiny object and the latest little spoon-fed pablum that greases their skids, they're all in.
Yep.
Without actually, you know, like the previous caller, they aren't digging into the actual issues and understanding what they mean.
Yep.
And it's probably a big reason why the House of Representatives could care less if they have a speaker or if they pass a single bloody law.
Yeah.
No government, right? That's right. The concept.
Appreciate the call, Rob. Thank you so much, Rob of Port Edwards. Do you feel that your legislator or legislators represent your interests? 844-967-2789. Let's go to Milwaukee. Scott, Milwaukee, thanks for listening. What say you?
Yes, good afternoon. Like your show today, like the topic.
Thank you much.
Said about the legislature, it's a good one, but I want to back up to your position about, I believe you stated the primary reason that the campus closed, the extension campus down by Platteville there, Richland Center, was a lack of funding. But as someone who's been involved with education 10 years, and I travel all over the state, see different campuses, it is declining enrollment, I can assure you. And it's not just, most of us know that are listening around the state, it's not just public institute closing. Cardinal Stritch closed in Milwaukee due to declining enrollment, as well as some fiscal issues there. But there are already a number of UW campuses, unfortunately, that are operating in the red. because the students are not there. And in 2025, it's going to really, a number of them are going to really fall off the cliff based on demographics, or when they're going to be an all-time low.
And I respect the, I'm running out of time here, Scott, but I respect the call. I agree there is declining enrollment, but the Richland Center had their key recruiter not funded. And when the local foundation offered $600,000 to keep that recruiter, Platteville and System said no. So I think there is a balance of not having enough funding to get good recruiters to help keep enrollment where it's at. Back with more in Hour 2. Don't go anywhere. The Todd Aaron Show on Civic Media.